Hello, I'm Stephanie with Vaddio, and welcome to part 4 in our video series about how to create custom static graphics for the AV Bridge MatrixMIX.
Vaddio is a US-based pro AV manufacturer whose goal is to make your AV experience easy. Our AV Bridge MatrixMIX is a full production video switcher that includes HDMI, USB, and IP streaming outputs, and its easy interface lets first-time users run a high-quality presentation with minimal experience.
If you haven't already caught our first few videos in this series covering video layers and keying, design tips, and importing graphics into the AV Bridge MatrixMIX, you may wish to go review those first. This video is going to cover actually creating the graphics for the MatrixMIX, and I'm going to be referencing tips and theories from previous videos. To start creating graphics for the AV Bridge MatrixMIX, basically you're just going to need an image editing program. If you want to take advantage of alpha graphics, you're going to need a program like Adobe Photoshop or GIMP or Paint.net, just to name a few options. Microsoft Paint is great for creating Luma or Chroma graphics, but it doesn't allow you to edit a graphics alpha layer, which is necessary for creating alpha keying graphics. I'm going to be using Adobe Photoshop CC and Microsoft Paint for Windows 10 for this tutorial, but the same basic concepts that we're going to be discussing can be translated to any image editing program. All right, so here's the really exciting part. Let's start making some graphics. We're gonna start with making a alpha channel or alpha keying graphic in Adobe Photoshop. So let's get in there. We're gonna start, just create new. And like we talked about earlier, we are going to start a canvas with the dimensions 1920 by 1080. Now, if you would like to, you can always import a frame of your video to help determine kind of the framing of your video, you know, whether that's, hey, your speaker's over here, and so I wanna make my graphic in adjustment of that. Kind of whatever you wanna do. If that's something that would help you, then I recommend that you try it. Otherwise, we'll just proceed as usual. So, in Photoshop, you have layers that are very similar to the layers that we were talking about in the video on the MatrixMIX. The top one is going to be on top, and you can specify which layers turn on or off to make your final composite image. So all the layers here don't necessarily need to be here at the end. You know, whatever's visible when you go to save the file is going to be what ends up being visible. So I've just hit the background. We're not going to delete it. You can if you would like, but I'm going to turn it off, and so it's not going to be visible in our final output. Now you might notice that the checkerboard pattern in the background of my canvas looks very similar to the checkerboard pattern that was in the MatrixMIX. In general, programs that offer opacity, you're going to see the background of the canvas being a checkerboard pattern, and that's because if it's a solid color, it's difficult to see the opacity of something through, it just looks like a lighter color or a darker color if your background is white or black. So the checkerboard is kind of the standard, and you're gonna see that on all programs that offer this, opacity, the alpha channel. It's kind of one of the mainstays. You're gonna have layers that you can turn on and off, and you're gonna have a checkerboard for when things are, basically invisible to show, hey, there's nothing here. This is fully opaque to show whatever's going to be underneath through. So with that in mind, let's start making kind of more of a full screen graphic. This one's going to be super duper simple. We're going to start, let's go for kind of a blue here. And I'm going to start by making my new layer fully blue. Just use the paint bucket tool to basically splash the whole thing in a blue color. And then you're going to find in your programs that there's going to be a spot to define opacity for a specific layer. You can have other ways to define opacity within the layer. This one just kind of, you know, affects the whole layer, you know, and how visible or not it is. I'd like to start at 90. That's kind of my preferred one for like a full screen graphic over video. Obviously adjust to taste, but as you can see, you can definitely see the blue in the image. It's not so, you know, invisible that it barely shows up, but you can still definitely see the pattern behind it, so that it, you know, lets you see both that there's something going on in the background, but obviously it's not your final production output, which is kind of the intent of this graphic that I'm going to be making. You can make it very fancy, obviously, but this is going to be just kind of a demo. So I'm just going to make an intermission graphic. I'm going to change the text on here, actually, to make it a different color so that it pops a little bit more. We're going to go for a light aqua. So, as you can see, this graphic follows a lot of the things that we went over previously when we were discussing designing graphics. The background serves as kind of an outline of the text to provide some contrast. The text itself is fully opaque. There's no opacity at all. The background is going to offer some opacity so that you can see what's going on. You can see maybe people getting back to their seats when intermission starts to be, you know, close to being over, something like that. And one other thing that I do definitely want to show you here is that, like I said, you can turn layers on and off so that you can have layers just to test certain things. These more advanced programs are always going to have something that you can use to convert your image to grayscale, so you can check for good contrast for, you know, folks who are colorblind. So it's generally called the saturation in these programs. So I'm going to create a saturation layer. And then I actually just need to move that to the top of the order so that it affects everything. And you can see that once I have, you know, saturation put in there, that we have a really good contrast between those two. So I'm going to turn that off for when we save the final image, but, you know, it can be nice to just put there to test and turn it on and off and see if you're going in the right way with your graphic. And then as an example, I'm going to turn the background back on. I'm going to, you know, give my... Ooh, that's actually a very light color. Let me get a black color so that you can see my stick figure a lot better. So, you know, if I do have someone here setting up on the stage, you can see that you can see them behind the graphic. So it's a nice level of opacity. When you do save alpha graphics, you're going to want to save them as a .png, because that is the file type that works in the MatrixMIX that accepts that alpha layer. The other two, again, are JPEG and bitmap, and those are single flat images. They don't allow for that alpha channel storage. So, you know, name it whatever you would like. Looks like I already have an intermission, so I'm gonna name this one intermission 2. And there you go, you're ready to load that up in the MatrixMIX. So now let's go over just kind of how to create something in Paint. And again, Paint is good for Luma and Chroma graphics. So that's what I would, you know, recommend you stick to. Obviously, you can't do alpha graphics in Paint. And because you're doing Luma and Chroma, remember for those two, a pixel is either on or off. You know, it's either there or you can see through it. And since pixels are square shapes, I like to stay with things that are rectangular or squarish shaped, because those offer kind of the cleanest cut out. So you can see our canvas size is not actually the right size here. So let's resize our canvas before we start drawing on it. 1920 by 10. And I have to turn the aspect ratio off here so that I can affect them. Otherwise, those two adjust in proportion to one another. All right, so here's a full 1920 by 1080 canvas, and I actually have to zoom out a little bit so that we can see it. But here we go, same thing that we did in Photoshop. Instead of making like the full screen graphic, I'm gonna do a lower thirds title, or a kind of, you know, a thing to name a speaker. So I'm gonna make that, let's make that kind of the green. And I'm gonna use the paint bucket to fill that in. And I'm gonna use this lighter yellow color to do the text. We can obviously pick something a lot more fun later, but this is just for an example. So this is gonna be me, I'm gonna be your speaker. I'm a member of the Hedgehog Appreciation Society, which is just a fictional society that I just made up. Because hedgehogs are great and I really do appreciate them. Okay, now unlike the previous thing, you might notice for our background, we have to have a solid color. There's no checkerbox again, no alpha channel. So we're not able to work in layers, so I can't put like a hue saturation layer on top to, you know, make sure that this is great for, you know, folks who are colorblind. There are a lot of free things on the web that you can load something into and convert to grayscale. So that would be the thing that I would put into your search engine, convert image to grayscale, and they'll generally let you upload one and then show you what it looks like after they've, you know, converted it, pulled all the saturation out. So you can use that to still check your work, because that's not a feature that is offered in just general Microsoft Paint, unfortunately. So the other thing that we need to do is we need to define everything that we don't want visible in this image as black. So we're gonna use the true black here up in the top corner and dye around there. And there we go. That would be a nice just lower thirds title for somebody. Obviously you can get a little bit fancier. You can, you know, have some gradation. You can start with an original kind of image or pattern and cut it down to the title size, you know, get really fancy with it. But these are just the basics of how you would do this. So here it is in Microsoft Paint. And then you can go again, save this. You can save this one as a PNG, a bitmap, or a JPEG. In general, I prefer .png or PNG files simply because they have a pretty good compression and they are basically lossless. So you will still maintain that true black in the background. Whereas when you start to compress things with a JPEG, you know, sometimes you get those kind of close to black, but not true black pixels and things like that. All right, so kind of for our last example, what I'm gonna show you how to do is to resize an existing image. You know, sometimes someone might hand you something that's too big and you need to size it down to fit on the canvas where you would like. So we're gonna show you how to make a watermark. So I'm gonna go back to Adobe Photoshop for that. And we are gonna open an existing file. So I'm gonna open this Vaddio logo. And instead of it being like a full screen right over my face logo, I don't want it to be full screen like that. I would like it to be down in the corner. We're gonna change its color and we're gonna change its size. So one of the things that you wanna do is that you wanna select the part that you want to resize. You can resize the canvas. I generally find that for me, I can't, you know, adjust it to taste. I don't get an idea of where it is in relation to the rest of the video. So I like to maintain my canvas size and just adjust the image. So I'm gonna select the part that I would like to adjust. And in Photoshop, you can do a shortcut for basically transforming, which is kind of the resizing tool, as Control T. Different programs are gonna have different commands, but that's just, you know, your quick little shortcut in Photoshop. One thing that you do want to know is that almost every program has it where if you hold shift or control, you can maintain the aspect ratio, because otherwise you could resize it and, you know, squish it a little horizontally or vertically. Whereas if you hold shift, it allows you to just scale up and down proportionately rather than kind of accidentally stretching or skewing. If I let go, you can see how it lets me kind of move it in ways that I don't want to do, especially for a logo, because someone has defined how that should look. So that's your little handy trick, hold down shift. So I think that's a good size in relation to our video, so I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna apply that, and I'm gonna move that down to the bottom left corner. Now I would like that to be, we're gonna make that gray, so we're gonna add in that saturation layer. And in fact, I'd actually like it to be white. So once I've pulled all the color out of it, I'm also going to lighten it We're gonna turn it white. And then I'm gonna move its opacity for a watermark, so it's not gonna put too much contrast. I'm not gonna stick up with my normal 90. I'm gonna go all the way down to 60. And actually, oops, the 60 should be applied to the bottom layer. So let's try that again. 60. All right, and you can see how it's, you can see some of the checkerboard through it, and that would be our watermark. So that's how you can easily resize a shape, again, maintaining the aspect ratio, control shift. You know, there are some programs that handle resizing images a little bit better than others. Again, something like Photoshop is a little bit more powerful. It's also a little bit more expensive, but it's gonna make your image look a little bit cleaner than, say, Microsoft Paint. It's not gonna be as smooth. So yeah, that was the quick and dirty how to make some graphics. You know, get creative. You know, start, hopefully take some inspiration from some of the ones that you've seen previously in the video series. But please use this to make fantastic presentations with your AV Bridge MatrixMIX.